After starting this module, you shall be able to know the various features of the company, learn the doctrine of corporate veil, identify the cases when corporate veil of a company may be lifted.
We will commence our discussion by studying the concept of company. Company is an incorporated association of persons created by law to pursue expressly laid down objectives. Chief Justice Marshall of USA has defined a company as a person, artificial, invisible, intangible, existing only in the eyes of law. Being a mere creation of law, it possesses only those properties which the charter of the company confers upon it, either expressly or as incidental to its very existence.
We shall now focus on features of company. Incorporated association. Company is an incorporated association of persons created by the law of the country. In India, companies are formed and registered under the Companies Act 2013, previously under the Act of 1956. Incorporation of a company requires registration of formal documents with the Registrar of Companies. Memorandum of Association is an important document which contains the fundamental conditions and purposes for which a company is formed. In fact, a company does not have its existence beyond its Memorandum of Association. The other important document is the Articles of Association, which lay down the rules and regulations for governance of the company. The Registrar's Certificate or the Certificate of Incorporation grants a legal entity to a company, enabling it to discharge functions such as entering into contract, purchasing, owning, and holding of properties. A company may be held liable for breach of law. It can sue and be sued in its name.
We shall now discuss the concept of independent legal entity. A company has a legal entity distinct and separate from its constituent members, who are none other than shareholders. It is an autonomous body, self-controlling and self-governing. It can hold and deal with any type of property of which it is the owner, in any way it likes. It can enter into contracts, open a bank account in its own name, sue and be sued by its members as well as outsiders. The rights and obligations of a company are distinct from its constituent members. Shareholders are not, in the eyes of law, part owners of the undertaking. The undertaking is something different from the totality of the shareholders. Shareholders cannot be held liable for the wrongs or misdeeds of the company. A company has a nationality, domicile, and residence, but cannot ask for enforcement of those fundamental rights which are exclusively available to national citizens. The nationality of the company, however, does not depend upon the nationality of its shareholders. A company can enter into partnership with one or more individuals or another company. It can buy shares or debentures of another company. A company can form other companies by subscribing to their memorandum of association. A company can be held liable for criminal acts. It can be held liable for breach of law and can be made to pay fine. However, no imprisonment of a company is possible. It can be charged with conspiracy to defraud or may be convicted of making use of false documents with intent to deceive. It can also be held liable for torts committed by its employees in the course of their employment. On account of this independent corporate existence, are creditors of the company alone, and their remedy lies against the company and its property only, and not against any of its members. Law recognizes the existence of the company quite irrespective of the motives, intentions, scheme or conduct of the individual shareholders. The principle of separate legal entity of the company was judiciously recognized by the House of Lords in the year 1867 in the case of O'Case versus Turcan and Holdings in the year 1867. It was then held that since an incorporated company has a legal personality distinct from that of its members, a creditor of such a company has remedy only against the company and not against an individual shareholder. Thus, a creditor of an incorporated company has remedy only against the company for its debts and not any of the members of whom it is composed. The position was further clarified by the House of Lords in the famous case of Solomon versus Solomon and Company Limited in the year 1897.
We shall now study the concept of separate property. The corporate property is clearly distinguished from the members' property, and members have no direct proprietary rights to the company's property, but merely their shares. Change in the constitution of the company's membership will not cause any realization or slitting of its property. A company cannot be the property of the person who owns all the shares in the company, nor can it be considered to be his agent. No member can either individually or jointly claim any ownership rights in the assets of the company during its existence or on its winding up. No shareholder has any right to any item of property owned by the company, for he has no legal or equitable interests therein. A member cannot have any insurable interest in the property of the company. We shall now consider the case of Macora versus Northern Assurance Company Limited, 1925. Mr. Macora was the holder of nearly all the shares except one of a timber company. He was also the substantial creditor. He insured the company's timber in his own name. The timber was destroyed by fire. It was held that the insurance company was not liable to compensate, as Macora had no insurable interest in the property, which belonged to the company only. Let us now throw some light on the concept of perpetual existence. A company has a perpetual succession. It has no allotted span of life. The mode of incorporation and dissolution of a company and the right of the members to transfer shares freely guarantee the continuity of the existence of the company, quite independent of the life of the members. The existence of a company can be terminated only by law. Being an artificial person, it cannot die irrespective of the fact that its members, even the founders or subscribers to the memorandum, may die or go out of it. Moreover, in spite of the changes in the membership of the company, it can perform its contracts and enter into future agreements. Thus, members may come and go, but the company can go on forever. We shall now study about common seal. Though a company has an artificial personality, it acts through human beings who are called as directors. They act as agents to the company, but not to its members. All the acts of the company are authorized by its common seal. The common seal is the official signature of the company. A document not bearing the common seal of the company will not be binding on the company. We shall now throw some light on the separation of ownership and management. A company is owned de facto by a number of shareholders, which is too large a body to manage the affairs of the company. Shareholders set the objectives of the company and appoint their representatives or agents, known as directors, to manage the affairs of the company on their behalf to pursue their objectives. The directors, in turn, hire professional managers, executives, to run the day-to-day operations of the company under their supervision and control. This striking feature of separation of ownership and management has raised many issues which gave rise to evolution of corporate governance as the focal point of modern corporations.
We shall now discuss the limited liability concept. The liability of a shareholder of a company is different from the liability of the company. Shareholders generally have limited liability. Liability to the extent of unpaid value of shares held up by the shareholders. Shareholders have no obligation to the company once they have paid full amount on the shares held by them. In cases of losses, the shareholders are not called upon to make good the losses. Creditors cannot claim from the personal wealth of the shareholders. In case of a guarantee company, the members are liable to contribute a specified agreed sum to the assets of the company in the event of company being wound up. Company law of many countries, including India, also provides for a company with unlimited liability, but such companies are very few and are in the nature of non-trading companies, that is, pursuing religious or socially useful objects. There are few exceptions when the shareholders or officers of a company may be called upon to compensate the company for the losses suffered by the company. Or, in case of officers, including directors, are found to be negligent in discharging their duties. This is known as piercing of the corporate veil.
We shall now have to focus on the transferability of shares. One can sell one's share of ownership rights to an interested buyer as the shares of a company are transferable, while in case of public companies, shares are freely transferable, which is provided by the law. There are some restrictions in the transferability of shares of private companies. In fact, transferability of shares and limited liability are the enabling factors for the tremendous rise of companies all over the world. Let us now move on and study lifting up of the corporate veil. Though a company is a person created by law, legal persona, and it has a distinct entity, yet in reality, it is an association of persons who are in fact the beneficial owners of all the corporate property. The persons behind a company are disregarded once they have formed a company and given to their association the status of a legal entity. There are, however, certain cases when this corporate veil of company will be probed into and lifted up. The cases can be put under two categories. 1. Cases falling under judicial interpretation. 2. Cases falling under express statutory provisions.
Under judicial interpretation, when the notion of a legal entity is used to defeat public convenience, justify wrong, protect fraud, or defend crime, the law will regard the corporation as an association of persons. Courts have in general disregarded the concept of independent corporate personality in those cases where corporate personality has been blatantly used as a cloak for fraud or improper conduct or doing things against public policy or for evading individual responsibility. Such cases can be put as follows for determining the character of the company. In case it is suspected that the company is owned by the enemies of the country, the courts may in their discretion disregard the corporate veil and examine the character of the persons in the real control of corporate affairs. To allow alien enemies to trade under corporate facet is against public policy. The leading case that can be cited here is Daimler Company Limited versus Continental Tires and Rubber Company in the year 1916. A company was incorporated in England to sell tires manufactured by a German company. The German company held majority of the shares in the English company and all its directors were Germans. Thus, the real control of the company was in German hands. During the World War I, the company brought a case to recover a trade debt. The court was requested to restrain the company from doing so since it belonged to alien enemies. The company was barred from maintaining the suit. It was observed that a company is not a natural person with mind or conscience. It cannot be loyal or disloyal. It can be neither friend nor enemy. But it may assume an enemy character when a person in de facto control of its affairs are residents in an enemy country or wherever residents are acting under the control of enemies. For the benefit of revenues, courts may brought the corporate shell of a company if it appears that the company has been formed for only the purpose of evasion of taxes or to circumvent tax obligations. Courts may refuse to identify the shareholders with the company when it is against the interest of the revenues of the government. The leading case that can be cited here is Sir Dinshaw McKenzie Pettit in the year 1927. It was held that the company was formed by the assessee purely and simply as a means of avoiding super tax, and the company was nothing more than the assessee himself. It did no business but was created simply as a legal entity to ostensibly receive the dividends and interests and to hand them over to the assessee as pretended loans for preventing evasion of personal and statutory obligations. The court may disregard the separate existence of a company where it appears that a company was formed for evading contractual and statutory obligations. The reference case that can be cited here is Guilford Motor Company versus Horn in the year 1933. It was held that the company started by Horn was a mere cloak or sham for the purpose of enabling him to commit a breach of his agreement against solicitors, and therefore it was restrained from enticing away Guilford Motor Company's customers. Where a company is incorporated as a device or stratagem to conceal the identity of proprietors or fraud, the corporate veil shall be lifted up. If an individual forms a company to avoid specific performance of his contracts, court will enforce specific performance against the company. Further, court will not permit resorting to device or incorporation of a company to evade welfare legislation. A case reference that can be cited here is Workmen of Associated Rubber Industry Limited versus Associated Rubber Industry Limited. In this case, a company incorporated a subsidiary company and transferred to it some of its investments and securities only for the purpose of splitting the profits into two hands and thereby reducing the incidence of obligations to pay bonus. The Supreme Court held that the separate existence of the new company would be disregarded for the purpose of working out the amount of bonus payable to workers.
Under express statutory provisions, the Companies Act and other statutes provide expressly the circumstances where corporate veil of a company is disregarded. Following are some of those cases. Holding and subsidiary company relationship. A company is termed as a holding company when it has the power to control the composition of the board of directors of another company or holds a majority of its shares. The other company, called a subsidiary of the former company, has a separate legal entity. The principle of lifting the corporate veil is applicable in holding subsidiary company relationship in two cases. 1. Section 212 of the Companies Act requires a holding company to attach to its balance sheet copies of the balance sheet, profit and loss account, director's report and auditor's report of each of its subsidiaries. Further, listed companies are required as per the accounting standards to prepare consolidated balance sheet to give better information of the financial position of the group as a whole to the creditors, shareholders, and public. 2. Where in spite of subsidiary companies being separate legal entities, the facts and circumstances show that they are in reality parts of one concern owned by a parent company or a group as a whole. Investigation in the affairs of a company. If an inspector is appointed under Section 235 or 237 of the Companies Act to investigate the affairs of a company, he has the power to investigate also the affairs of any other related company in the same management or group, Section 239. This is in complete disregard to the separate entities of the companies. Investigation of ownership of a company. Where it appears to the central government that there is good reason to do so, it may appoint one or more inspectors to investigate and report on the membership of any company and other matters relating to the company for the purpose of determining the true persons, A, who are or have been financially interested in the success or failure, whether real or apparent, of the company, or B, who are or have been able to control or materially to influence the policy of the company, Section 247. It thus involves piercing the corporate veil. Directors with unlimited liability. Ordinarily, the liability of a director in a limited company is the same as that of the members of the company. There is nothing in the Act, however, to prevent their liability being made unlimited by memorandum of the company, or, if limited by memorandum, being converted into an unlimited liability in pursuance of authority given by the articles. The same principle applies also in the case of a manager of a limited company, Section 322. We shall now discuss about the fraudulent conduct of business. If in the course of the winding up of a company, it appears that any business of the company has been carried on with the intention to defraud creditors of the company or any other persons, the tribunal, on the application of the original liquidator or the liquidator, or on application of any other creditor or contributory of the company, may, if it thinks it proper so to do, declare that any persons who were knowingly parties to the carrying on of the business in the manner above said shall be personally responsible without any limitation of liability for all or any of the debts or other liabilities of the company as the court may direct. Section 339.
Failure to return application money. If the application money of those applicants whom no share has been allotted is not repaid up to the 45th day of the closure of the issue, then the directors of the company shall be jointly and severally liable to repay that amount with interest at the rate of 15% per annum from the expiry of 45th day. This is covered under Section 39, Subsection 3 of the Companies Act. Misrepresentation in prospectus. In the case of misrepresentation in a prospectus, every director, promoter and any other person who authorizes the issue of such a prospectus incurs liability towards those who subscribe for shares on the faith of untrue statements contained therein. Further, they may be held criminally liable also, that is covered under Section 34 of the Companies Act 1956. Misdescription of name. Directors and other officers of the company will be personally liable for all the contracts made by them on behalf of the company in their personal names. For example, acceptance of a bill of exchange drawn upon a company by a director in his personal name, or omitting to use the name of the company in the prescribed manner. For example, not using the word limited as a part of the company's name which is mandatory and covered under Section 147 of the Act. Non-payment of tax. When any private company is wound up and any tax assessed on the company, whether before or in the course or after liquidation in respect of any income of any previous year cannot be recovered, then every person who was a director of that company at any time during the relevant previous year shall be jointly and severally liable for the payment of such tax. He may, however, be exempted from this liability in case he proves that non-payment of tax was not due to any gross negligence, misfeasance or breach of duty on his part. This is covered under Section 179 of the Income Tax Act 1961.
Moving on, we shall now discuss the liability of promoters for pre-incorporation contracts. Promoters will be personally liable for all those pre-incorporation contracts which are not adopted by the company after incorporation. We shall discuss the various ultra vires acts. The directors of the company will be personally liable for all those acts which they have done on behalf of the company if they are 1. Ultra vires the company, or 2. Ultra vires the directors if the company does not adopt their acts. Liability under other statutes. There are many other provisions of the company law where directors of a company are personally liable for the default in complying with those provisions. Some of these are non-maintenance of proper books of accounts, default in holding of annual general meetings, default in filing the annual returns, default in paying dividends after declaration, false declaration of solvency, non-cooperation with the company auditors or with the liquidators in the event of winding up of the company, non-compliance with the regulations of the Securities and Exchange Board of India. Besides these, directors may be held liable under pollution laws, social security laws, example, Minimum Wages Act, ESI, EPF, Gratuity, Competition Act, Foreign Exchange Management Act, and taxation laws. In all the discussed cases, the corporate veil shall be broken through and the company shall not be allowed to use its legal entity to give shelter to the fraudulent or otherwise guilty persons.
Slide 39. Let us summarize what we have learnt in this module. The company has various features like perpetual succession, common seal, independent legal entity, artificial person, incorporated association, transferability of shares, limited liability, separation of ownership and management. The entity of a company is separate from its members. The separate entity of a company, which is also called corporate veil, may be lifted under certain situations. The situations under which the corporate veil may be lifted are classified under two categories: judicial interpretations and statutory provisions.